Welcome to this introductory video about the data plane and software-defined networking. In this short video, I will briefly introduce you into the data plane functionalities and guide you through an introduction into software-defined networking. So what is now the job of the data plane? So basically the main job of the data plane is processing a large volume of packets. There's millions of packets per second that enter a high-performance router, and packets come in streams of data, and they run a clever algorithms on these switches which are used to process these packets. And in order to be really super fast in the data rate, there's only very small time available to process a single packet on the order of a few nanoseconds. So therefore, the algorithms which can be executed on a per packet basis, they need to be really simple in order to be run super fast. Some examples that these algorithms do are they're matching on some bit fields and action and having simple actions operated on the packets. For example, dropping packets, forwarding packets to a given port, encapsulating them in another packet, and so on. Different data plane implementation run in different devices. For example, if there's a data plane running at the end host, this is typically run in a network interface card, or also called NIC. If they run inside a network, they can run at different devices such as routers, switches, or firewalls, which also process the packets. There's a bunch of different functionality that we can distinguish what data plane operations are exercised upon packets. For example, a switch will simply forward packets or drop them. A firewall, for example, is implementing some access control, checking up some list, and determining if a given sender is allowed to access a given service or not. Tunneling is much used in wireless networks and also packet core networks for the mobile packet core in order to implement mobility solutions. So the process of tunneling is to encapsulate a packet with an outer header that is then used, for example, at the next switch for determining the forwarding behavior. Traffic monitoring is another functionality that is implemented at the data plane in order to count how many packets have been received from a given flow, from a given traffic aggregate, and so on. Also, packets need to be buffered at the switch and they need to be marked according to given marking rules to check if they comply with traffic profiles or if they are out of traffic profiles. Also, to treat multiple users, and each user may have a different priority. Clever shaping and scheduling algorithms need to be implemented in order to get access to the resources that the switch has and regulate that access. Finally, deep packet inspection may be required by some network operators in order to check for malicious packets, and this is typically done in a separate box, which is a so-called DPI, deep packet inspection box. If we now look a little bit under the hood of a typical data plane processing element, such as a switch, we will see two different elements typically in a normal switch. One is the control plane, which is implemented by typically a normal processor which runs in the switch. So the job of the control plane is typically to calculate the forwarding table, which is determining the output port based on the destination address of the packet that the switch currently processes. So in addition to the control plane, the data plane inside the switch manages each individual incoming packets. So for each packet that comes into each port, basically it check up the destination address, and basically, for example, the switch looks as a destination MAC address, the routers look at the longest IP prefix. Based on that destination address, they look up in their table which outgoing port should be used to send the packet to. And the action that the data plane then exercises upon this packet is to send this packet to the identified output port. And basically, The switching fabric inside the switch directs the packet from the input to the output port in a very fast way. In addition to the control in the data plane, there's typically an interface that connects these two together. And this interface is used for control signaling that the control plane installs table entries into the data plane that are then used by the data plane to do the forwarding and lookup decisions. So mostly the control plane exercises table management operations to install new table entries, to remove table entries, and that is based typically in a normal switch on the routing protocol functionality that the switch has. Another type of operation the data plane does is access control. Access control is a sort of packet filtering operation based on access control lists. In this example that we see here on the right hand side, we have a router which basically connects to the left, an admin user with the IP address 10.0.1.1, and a user on the lower side with the IP address 10.0.1.3, and the other client is connected at the IP address 10.0.1.2. And the access control specifies to allow all packets to pass from the admin port towards the 10.0.1.2 port, but allow email and deny telnet for all other users. So for example, for this user, there would be the telnet packets would be needed to be blocked. So typically this access control list is specified by entries which specify if the operation is permitted or not. And entries typically contain source destination IP address, source destination ports, and protocol IDs. As such, access control operation can be quite complex to detect security attacks. They are mostly stateful operation. For example, we would like to block all TCP SYN packets from the outside in order to not allow TCP SYN flooding attacks. So that requires typically to parse TCP headers and maintain per-flow state information in order to detect the TCP state of the connection and identify that the attack now is happening. So in this slide here, we see an example of an access control list, which basically shows on the right hand side in this table for a given entry if the packet will be dropped or accepted. So in this example, in the first entry tells us that all packets coming from the IP address 1234 having the destination address 5678 have been accepted or should be accepted. The second entry specifies that all packets going to destination subnet 1.2.3.star should be dropped. Third entry specifies that all packets having the destination IP address 1.2.3.8, where the destination port is not equal 53, should be accepted, and so on. So basically, the access control list is an ordered list of accept and drop actions. And as you see in this table number in the row number 2, wildcard rules are possible. So that means the rule in the table entry number 2 tells us that all packets which belong to any host at the destination network 1.2.3 should be dropped. Because list entries in this example, as you see, can easily overlap, we need a priority for ordering which action should be triggered in case of two or more rules or access control list entries match the current packet. So this is also done for packet classification. So for example, we would match header fields and identify the match with the highest priority. There is, in order to implement that in an efficient way, there is different approaches typically used. One approach is to use multi-dimensional classification algorithms because we have multiple dimensions that we need to identify. And the other one, more efficient one, is to use this ternary content addressable memory, which is a special data structure which can do such match operation really fast. Another data plane operation is network address translation, also called NAT. What is a network address translation box doing? So basically, a NAT maps between internal and external network addresses. In this example here, the external network is 134.60.70.73, and the internal network is 139.70.60.1. And we see here in this example that inside the internal network, there's multiple IP addresses, which have different IP address, different prefix than what our network has. So the job of the NAT device is to map between the IP addresses between end hosts and the NAT. And because each connection needs to be unique, we will use port information or ports in order to identify each connection. So we use a NAT table in order to do the mapping, and basically the NAT table entries are dynamically created. So when new flows are detected, NAT table entries are inserted. The question then is, when do we remove the entries if the flow ceases to exist? How do we know that a given flow does not send any packets anymore and that a new flow has started? Also, problems are how to detect if both ends are behind the NAT and what to do then. So it's not very simple to do. In this example here, we have an IP packet which has the source address then 01.3 with the source port 1024 should be sent to the destination address 134.60.70.73 to the destination port 80. So the NAT would map this to an IP packet, would rewrite basically the IP and the port header fields to send from the source address 139.70.60.1, which is its own IP address, from the source port 1024 to the destination address 134.60.70.773, destination port 80. So all packets which come from this source IP address 10.0.0.1.3 with the source port 1024 are rewritten by changing the source IP address. In the next example, the source 10.0.1.1 with the source port 1024 to the destination address 134.60.77.73, destination port 80, this need to be mapped to the source IP address of the switch, which is 139.70.60.1, but the source port 1024 has been used by these other users, so we have to have a different source port, which in this example is 1025, and so on. So by this kind of operation, we would populate the NAT table entries, and when a packet comes, we will look up the NAT table entries and rewrite the IP IP header and port addresses. Another job of the data plane is traffic monitoring. So why do we need to monitor traffic? Well, there's many reasons for why traffic monitoring is important. For example, network operators may want to do volume-based charging to charge you based on your tariff that you have. That is important for the mobile network. Another important way why we would monitor the traffic is for traffic engineering purposes, in order to detect congested links and route around congested links. So in order to detect that, we need to identify how many packets have been sent over a given port and so on. Or we would like to detect anomalies that now we can detect that a certain unusual traffic spike happens and so on. So how do we do the traffic monitoring? Well, as you see in this example here, the middle switch would like to monitor the traffic which passes through that switch. So basically for each input and for each output port, we would need to count the packets and the bytes. For example, we could count here for each destination IP address or for each destination subnetwork address, we count how many packets and bytes we have seen. This example for this destination IP address wildcard 1.2.3.*, we have seen two packets which have in total 3000 bytes and so on. So basically we would match the header fields. We would then update counters if we see packets that match these header fields. We would update packet counter and byte counter and basically populate this table in order to record how much traffic we have seen of a given flow or if a given aggregate traffic patterns. The challenge is to identify correct aggregates. So do we define proactively what are the traffic aggregates we would like to look into, or should we identify reactively traffic aggregates? Also, we would like to identify more information, for example, how much each time of a flow has spent in the queue, what is the congestion state of the switch, and so on. And some packets of a flow might pass through other nodes. For example, for MPTCP connections, some flows might pass through one router, while the other subflow might be routed over a different path. So we do not have necessarily all the information available in order to infer anomaly detection inside a switch. So typically, the traffic monitoring information we need to pass to other devices or monitoring platforms, which can aggregate many switches information together to have a better view on the traffic volume. Another job the data plane has to do is managing its buffer and its queues that the data plane has. So when multiple packets arrive, which should be forwarded to one port, and the packet aggregated packet arrival rate is higher than the serving capacity of the port, then typically queues build up. So when queues build up, we need to think how we treat the packets. The most simple way to treat the packets is to serve the packets in arriving order. So the first package which came into to the queue will be the first one sending out of that queue, which is called also FIFO queue or drop tail. This is because if the queue is full, any arriving packet is dropped. A more sophisticated way to manage the congestion in such switches is, for example, random early detection. The problem with first in, first out queuing is that if TCP packets will be dropped, it takes a round trip time until the sender reacts and reduces the rate. During this time, maybe this can be 50 milliseconds, TCP still sends at the high data rate, which may increase that congestion even further. So the idea of the random early detection is basically to drop earlier, even if the queue is not really full, in order to signal that implicitly as a congestion signal so that TCP can react. So in the random early detection, the queue drops earlier, and how much earlier it drops is a function of the buffer size. So here you see on the right-hand side, you see the diagram where you see on the y-axis the drop probability and on the x-axis you see the average queue depth. Alternatively, so you see in this example here that we have two types of traffic, a green traffic and a red traffic, and the dropping probability of the different traffic looks differently. So this we can use, for example, to treat different traffic classes in a different way and handle the priority of the different types of traffic, for example, voice, video, or web traffic. So we can map that nicely to DiffServe service points, where for each DiffServe service point, we would have a different dropping profile to implement different dropping probabilities for different traffic flows. Instead of also dropping, we could mark or signal the congestion to the end hosts earlier by, instead of dropping, marking packets. That we will see later in this course in an example how we can implement something like that in the data plane programming language P4. In addition, because in a normal switch we have multiple service classes available, we would have multiple queues in order to implement and segregate the traffic. So for example, we could have multiple traffic classes by separating the queues for each flow or traffic class. So voice flow would have its own, voice flows would have one queue, video flows would have one queue, web traffic would have one queue. But if you have more queues than a single one, then basically would need a scheduler to decide the serving order. In addition to having multiple traffic classes, so in this example here that you see on the right-hand side, lower right-hand side, we have two different queues. The red queue, maybe this is the voice packets, the green queues, maybe it's the video packets, and the scheduler decides for any given packet which queue to serve. In this example, he served two red packets before one green packet. Recently, a lot of research has been done into active queue management, the queues basically auto-tune their parameters in order to maintain a stable queuing latency target. The problem has been that for the random early detection, we need to specify disrupt probabilities and configure them appropriately. And there's many parameters to configure, which is difficult to do. Instead, for the AQM mechanisms, they have algorithms to dynamically tune their parameters based on the queue length and arrival rate, so to maintain, for example, a target queuing latency of 5 milliseconds. So examples of these AQM schemes is Caudal, PI, FQ-Caudal, and so on. Finally, we have seen that if we have multiple queues, we need to have a packet scheduling algorithm in order to determine the serving orders of the packets. This is when there are multiple queues to serve, and there's many algorithms available which have different complexity. For example, strict priority queuing, you would assign to each queue a priority number, and we always serve the queue with the highest priority first if it has packets. If it doesn't have packets, we serve the next queue with a lower priority number. Another more simple algorithm is round robin. Another simple algorithm is a round robin scheme, where we basically go through queues in a round robin way. So this is shown in the lower diagram, where we have two queues, a red and a green one. And we would first send one packet from the red one, then one from the green one, then from the red one, and so on. If the packet in the queue which we serve is there, then we serve it, otherwise we check the next one. And there's many variants also weighted fair scheduling, where we assign weights to queues, and instead of sending one queue per dequeue operation, we serve proportionally more packets according to what weight he assigned. So the higher the weight, the more packets we would dequeue. Finally, another data plane operation is a shaping of the traffic. Basically, that would mean we modify the packet rate to conform to a given profile. For example, you have a customer contract with the network operator for 10 megabits, but we are sending more than 10 megabits into the switch. Then the switch would run a rate shaping algorithm, basically to check your arrival rate and mark the packets to be conforming to your with your contractual rate with a given type of service field in the IP header, while we would mark those out of profiles with a different type of service bit. So this rate shaping of traffic can be used to avoid congestion on the downstream nodes, and there are several algorithms to do. For example, the leak and bucket algorithm allow us to control the maximum rate and burst duration for each flow or for traffic aggregates. So the leak bucket algorithm typically has tokens generated at a certain rate R, and the bucket has a certain depth D, as you can see in this illustration. And basically, when packets are arriving, the packet will only be forwarded if there is tokens available. And the tokens are generated regularly at arrival rate R. So such leaky bucket algorithm allow us to control the maximum rate and the maximum burst duration. So when the packets are coming, we can mark the packet to signal the downstream or end hosts that congestion is building up. So for example, with the ECN, this early congestion notification, basically we would reuse some of the IP header fields, for example, this IP type of service bits, to basically signal to the downstream or end host if congestion is building up. And we can use a buffer state information, so we could combine that with the RED information and so on. So how we mark it? So basically, the end host can mark it based on application information. So the end host would know this is a gaming application, and he marks with a certain priority all the gaming packets. But then the question is, can the network trust the end host that the application marks accordingly, or do all application on this end host mark everything as gaming application to gain advantage? Another way to mark it is that network nodes mark the packets based on traffic classes, but then the question is, how do the network know the application requirements? Because then the network need to know the application requirements in order to stamp the correct type of service bits. The final question we need to solve is how to identify traffic classes. So for example, how do we know that this is a video flow or audio flow? So should we use IP information based on source, port, and destination, IP address and destination port numbers, and assuming that a certain video flow always is sent to that given port information? Or do we have sophisticated machine learning algorithm to identify based on traffic patterns the different traffic classes? Rate limitations, so how do we identify what traffic conforms to a given profile and what is out of the profile? Having reviewed now many different data plane implementation aspects, so we now ask the question, what is software-defined networking? So having looked at the different jobs of the data plane, we have to look at the common obstructions and identify common obstructions, and based on this common obstruction, we can maybe find higher level services and group them accordingly. So what are the common obstructions? Let's look at the router. A router is forwarding based on destination address. It's implementing access control on these 5 tuples, on the IP source destination addresses, on the source and destination ports, and the protocol IDs. A router is doing packet scheduling, packet marking, packet queuing, and a router is doing traffic monitoring. Firewall. Firewall is doing access control based on these 5 tuples. It has stateful firewall and stateless firewall information. A NAT, what is a NAT doing? A NAT is mapping port numbers and addresses and is rewriting IP address and port numbers. A switch. A switch is basically forwarding on destination MAC address having switch MAC address tables in order to find out when a packet comes to what destination MAC address it should be, to which port it should be sent based on the destination MAC address. Is using local learning algorithm to build a switch table. Packet shaper is used basically to classify packets and shape the traffic accordingly. So the common obstruction basically that the data plane we can identify that is has manifested itself in the definition of this open flow protocol. So the open flow protocol is a protocol that enables software-defined networking and it standardizes a way to interact with a data plane device, typically like a switch or a router. So the main idea is to specify an abstract switch model, which is basically matching on some packet fields, for example, on some IP addresses, destination addresses, IP destination addresses, on some ports, on some header fields, on some subset of the header fields, on MPLS labels, it's matching on the ports. And this basically matching is supported by most of the switch, even hardware implementation, by this TCAM implementation, which run at very, very high speed. So we identify commonalities in our packets using such match operation, which look at the header fields. And then we treat the packets by applying actions. So if we find a match, we perform action on that packet. And action can be very simple. For example, we can drop the packet. So a firewall would drop all the packets where the access control list says this is not allowed. We can rewrite header fields. So in a NAT, we rewrite IP addresses and port numbers. We can forward on a given port. So a switch and a router forwards on a given destination port address based on lookup in some table where we have found some matches. We can count packets for the traffic monitoring. And we can also float all packets to all outgoing ports. So this match action abstraction is like the key concept, one of the key concepts of software-defined networking, which allow us to abstract many data plane instances like switches, routers, firewalls, NATs, packet shapers, and associate the packet with a certain flow to identify certain flows based on these matches and associate action to either individual flow or traffic aggregates. So in this software-defined networking, basically, we use the OpenFlow protocol as a standardized model that we can use to program the network devices. So basically, it is based on this match action abstract. So in software-defined networking, basically, we define very simple switches, which are very dumb devices, which has a data plane and a control plane. But compared to a normal switch, a SDN switch has a very, very dumb control plane. It does basically have no intelligence at all. Instead, it has an interface which allow a SDN controller, which running on a different device, to install flow table entries, which match action, which fill in these tables with matches and actions. Basically, on top of this SDN controller, on the northbound interface, they run a set of control functions or applications, and many applications on a single controller, which implement our network functionality that we would like to have. The main contribution of the open of the software-defined networking is the OpenFlow protocol, which is a standardized protocol which interacts with the switch. So in this example here, this is one implementation of the southbound interface, which is this OpenFlow protocol, which can be used to download flow table entries into the switch or query statistics from the switch and pull the statistics to the SDN controller. And OpenFlow basically, it has standardized this match action abstraction model, and it logically centralized the control plane via a single entity, which is called the SDN controller. So basically, now our control plane is implemented by the SDN controller, which basically uses the OpenFlow protocol to install flow table entries to the simple control plane at the switch, which takes these flow table entries and installs it in the data plane TCAM, or in the data plane flow tables that are in the switch pipeline. So that very much simplifies the control plane, because we can now run on a logically centralized platform, which allow us to implement a lot of centralized algorithms for traffic engineering and so on, which simplifies our network design in a very radical way. So I think it's very fair to say that SDN has really changed the way we operate networks for the better. And it also simplifies the network debugging, because instead of having this distributed controller plane algorithms, we have a single logically centralized controller which runs here all the algorithms in a single box. Of course, for scalability purposes, the SDN controller can be replicated, and we have multiple SDN controllers responsible for a set of switches, but then the SDN controllers would talk with each other. So this SDN brought the concept of logically centralized control to our networks. And this is convenient because it really helps to simplify the control plane, since we no longer have to wait for the distributed algorithms, the distributed routing algorithms, to converge. And we have one central view of our network. For example, SDN controller can build a network graph as a data structure where the external control functions, the application on top, would run on top and use this network view to do their traffic engineering, say, for example. However, this approach to SDN has some issues. So if you look at the OpenFlow, the data plane protocol evolution requires changes to the OpenFlow standard. For example, in the first version of the OpenFlow, we had only a very limited number of match fields available. So the first version supported 12 header fields that you can match on, and now they are over 30 or so. So OpenFlow has already expanded quite a lot, and continue to do so as data plane protocols continue to change and new ones are created. And as we all know, that process of making changes to a standard takes quite a long time, because it takes time to implement or to converge to a new OpenFlow standard, then to convince the switch manufacturer to implement that and to test that and extend the controller functionality. But what even takes longer is that we have to update also the switching chip to support new data plane protocol. Another issue is the limited interoperability between vendors that provide SDN-enabled switched chips. Some speak OpenFlow, others speak NetConf, while others might speak some other SDN protocol. And these differences in the southbound interface must be handled as the SDN controller, which makes it quite complex to implement. Additionally, this approach provides limited programmability. When you buy an SDN-enabled switch, it will support some fixed set of fields you can match on and some fixed set of action that can be performed upon meeting the match criteria. But you cannot fundamentally change that set of match field or that set of actions. So these are exactly the issues that P4 tries to attempt to address. So the way to think about it is that OpenFlow and this traditional SDN model are really designed to give those who own and operate big networks control over the control plane. P4 is now meant to give network operators control over the data plane. So P4 and this whole programmable data plane movement is really a logical extension to what many of you probably think of as software-defined networking. And that finishes that overview about the data plane.